Okay. Hey, Sushant, congratulations on your 760. Okay, 760 with a V46. How does it feel?
It feels fantastic. I almost shouted an abuse when I got the score. definitely not what I was expecting because I felt the verbal was fairly tough. But in retrospect, I feel it got tough because of the because how it progresses, right? So I was maybe getting it all right. It felt a little uncomfortable during the test, not gonna lie. But I think at the back of my mind, subconsciously, I was trained well enough to recognize what could be the best. I'll be very honest, the questions were very tough and I wasn't 100% sure of all the options. But I think my mind was trained in the right direction to know what would be the best guess, which is the 80% most likely to be the correct answer. So yeah, I think felt great. And first of all, when I got the 760, I was so sure that it was going to be a Q51 because no one's going to get a 760 without Q51, right? And it went fairly well. The font, I felt maybe I did some silly mistakes. So when I saw Q49, I was very confused. How could it be that I got a 760 with a Q49 and then I saw the V46 and really blew my mind.
Yeah, so here's a learning for everybody, right? You don't need a Q51 to score a 760. That's one thing. I've seen a lot of students get a Q50 and a V42 as well, and get a 760. You've gotten a V46, so let's not even go in that direction because that's a crazy, crazy high score. Let's talk a little bit about, of course, your verbal journey, right? Now, the interesting thing about you is that you studied on your own and you scored a 710 before you kind of even joined the course. How did you study then and what was the difference from when you studied on your own to when you kind of came to us?
Got it. So, Dhananjay, I had taken a GMAT way back in 2014 as well. This was right after I graduated and I got a 700. Which was, I think, Q50 and a V33 or 34, something like that. Yeah. I felt that my SC had always been strongish, not where I wanted it to be, but of all the three sections, I think SC was my most consistent because I have a good grammar, a good catch on grammar as a person, but I did not still, I was relying a lot on sound, how it sounded. CR is something I think the pre-thinking is something I was doing before I started e-GMAT as well, but during the preparation phase of e-GMAT, I realized I wasn't doing it well enough, the pre-thinking that I was doing. And RC was by far the most inconsistent that I had. I had some mocks where I did zero mistakes in RC, and there were mocks where I only did mistakes in RC, right? So yes, I think the verbal had been a very tumultuous, very roller coaster journey. And the frustrating part was I could not pinpoint what my weakness and strengths are. I just knew that SC is consistent and RC is not, but I wasn't confident in any of the three sections. So I needed that help. That's where I reached out to one of e-GMAT's consultants, Anshul. And I said, see, my problem is very simple. I do not have a weakness area, a particular weakness area. I think all of the things I do is average. So I need to level up my game in all the sections. And that's where he walked me through the e-GMAT platform, as well as how to utilize the ability test, custom quizzes, as well as utilizing the score.
Got it. So after he kind of took you through everything, what were the first thing that you kind of started off with? Because you've done a fair amount of the SC, CR and RC course.
Yeah. So first of all, I wasn't even very sure that I wanted to take the course. I thought that maybe if he could help me pinpoint what I could do again in a self mode, maybe I could do that, save some money. To be very honest, I thought about it. I'm anyway giving the GMAT. If I nail it, I'm increasing my chances of scholarship. So that is actually a very small investment if I can increase my chances for a scholarship, right? And I thought the way he put it, how it would analyze where you are and where you want to be and how you're progressing. This is something that I wanted because I had been doing a 1 month prep. I did not know where I was and where I was progressing. It was just, it's all in the air, right? So that's where I decided, yes, let me make this investment. And I have to stick by it. He told me that you have to study about 20 hours a week, which is a lot when you are managing work as well.
True.
But yeah, I thought 1 month, let's give it my all. Not even 1 month, like 3 weeks. Let's give it my all and let's focus everything on verbal because there is only so much hope in quantum.
Yeah.
But a lot of hope in verbal, right? So yes, I started doing the concept files and Ranjit, one thing to all your potential subscribers, brilliant thing. I think one of the best things about e-GMAT, all the other things, yes, great. You would only be doing about 4 to 5 questions in half an hour or 40 minutes, but that will make all the difference. If you go through it diligently, don't skip anything. Learn even the smallest of things, how to comprehend a CR article, and not just pre-thinking, but how to comprehend each and every meaning of the word and sentence. I think that will make all the difference in CR, especially. So that was something which really upped my game in CR. Took me from about 50% accuracy to about 80-90% accuracy in CR. And SC, I can say that it really brought in that objectivity. People think that SC is very grammatical thing, it's a very subjective thing, right? It's not actually. You can actually break down the sentences and you can see where in, like you solve quant, it can be solved in that way. And that's where e-GMAT took me in that direction. And I was very happy that it.
Perfect. So I think you started off by analyzing an ability and you figure that, you know, SC is fine, CR is okay, RC is up and down. So again, value from the course. But then you've practiced a serious amount of, I think, more than 300, just about 300 questions on Scholaranium as well. And this is not an insane amount because we have tons and tons of questions, but I really value the fact that you didn't over practice because a lot of students tend to do that, right? So you practiced about 300 questions on Scholaranium. What was your experience on that platform?
It was amazing. So the reason why I was doing that Scholaranium, exactly what you said, it was not to over practice. I felt I was ready enough doing the ability, doing the concept files, the application files. Conceptually, I was ready. So I knew that, you know, I did not want to practice what I wanted through that because the verbal platform of e-GMAT is very close, almost similar to the original GMAT, right? And I knew, and I picked up the same amount of questions I don't know if you saw that, but I was always
picking 36. I did.
Right? The idea was stamina. Because the questions were about the same level. I picked up in the same proportion as well. I was told by your consultant, then wherever you are building custom quizzes, even though you might have specific areas to focus on, maybe you want to improve CR.
True.
But his suggestion was even then mix it up because in the real situation, it will be mixed up, true, right? So you do not want to get into a habit where you are practicing a lot of CR questions at one go because your mind gets conditioned in that way. So I mixed it up, 36 questions, real environment, 300 questions means about 9. So apart from your mock test, I maybe simulated another 9 verbal GMAT environment to build my stamina. And it really helped me during the test. I did not feel that, oh my God, I'm tired. I can't do quant and IR.
True. So I think in the week before the test, I think 7 to 10 days before the test, you took these 34, 35 question custom quizzes where we call them test readiness quizzes, where you scored above 80% and around the 75% mark. So for anyone who wants to know how to score a V40 plus, that's the benchmark. And this is with medium and hard questions. And I think it was very effective because it would have taught you multiple things. What were your main takeaways from these quizzes?
So one thing I really loved is the analysis part. Once I get through to so e-GMAT has this thing wherein they break down things into what is the luck factor, what is the rush queue factor, and one more I'm forgetting that section, but there were
timing factor
things.
The timing factor, so it's timing, rush queue, and luck.
Correct. So when e-GMAT shows you what your analysis, it does not just show you the incorrect ones. It also shows you what you did correct, but you took excessive time in, right? It was very important because you want to be comfortable on the test day. Even if you get it right, but you are spending about 3 minutes, 3.5 minutes on a CR or a SC question. Not a very comfortable position to be in. And it means that conceptually there might still be some gaps. So that's where I think that's where I utilized the platform really well. I analyzed each question on its merit. Not a lot of luck factor. I never guessed anything. So my luck factor throughout the test were almost negligible. There was rush through, and I analyzed. I picked where am I rushing? What are the things I think are easy, but they are maybe trying to trap me. So that's where e-GMAT helped a lot. And of course, all the incorrect answers. One thing I can give an advice on is it's in verbal especially. It's always very very easy to make a case for your answer, right? That you know my answer sounds correct. It sounds actually the best. I don't know how that answer can be correct. Go away from that trap because yes. If you're not trained that way, there is a subjectivity in verbal. But when you do get trained properly, you would realize that your answer is actually one of a very cleverly thought of trap they wanted you to pick. But the real answer is something else. And it's very objective how you pick it up. So that's how I utilize the platform to figure out. I admit it to myself, I'm wrong. I did not try to justify. I did not try to expose that, you know, your answer is wrong. Right, so that's where I utilized it and conceptually bridged the gaps.
Perfect. I think I couldn't have put it better myself. And I think the point that you mentioned that, for example, if I were to give these statistics of 80% on a test readiness quiz and it had a timing issue and a luck factor and a rush through factor, that amounts to actually much lesser then, because of course these elements reduce your score. So in the run-up to the test, again, you took just a few mocks, you took a few Sigma X mocks, and in fact I think you scored a 750 on Sigma X mock 2 days before the test, right? So you just took that. I mean, I've always known this for a long time that the Sigma X mocks are awesome, but tell me, as a student, you know, what do you think about, you know, the accuracy of the algorithm and kind of guessing what your score is at? Because, and the funny thing here is you scored 5 Q49s and you scored a Q49 on the test as well.
Correct. And I'll say it's almost absolutely bang on. Maybe a plus minus 10.
Fair.
So when I gave my earlier GMAT, I was getting around 680 in e-GMAT mocks. I even got a couple of 680s in the official GMAT mock as well. And those are said to be the most accurate, right? So if I got two 680s there, if I'm getting two 680s here, then immediately after my first GMAT, I again took it and I got about a 710 again. I think 730 perhaps. So fairly close to what the actual GMAT is, especially the verbal. I'll say the quant is a little bit tougher than what the official GMAT is, but that actually works in your favor, right? Because if you are ready for the tough ones, it will be a smooth sailing on the official day. But the verbal is actually bang on, especially I think all the three sections, but especially SC and RC, SC and CR, I feel that they are almost picked up from official GMATs. And yes, RC fairly similar as well.
I assure you, we haven't picked it up from there. But yeah, the algorithm is absolutely awesome. And I think there is value in that. So here's a very interesting data point. I think coming to the closure of this interview, I want you to talk a little bit about this. And I noticed this. Your scores in mocks, you've never hit a 760, right? Even when you gave the test before, you never hit like a 700 or a 710. You may have hit it once or twice, but you were getting 680s. But you did much better on the exam than you did on a mock. A lot of people, it goes the other way around. I want to understand from you, what is it that, how did you approach the exam to kind of, you know, outperform on the exam?
Got it. So I think, Dhananjay, I'll be very honest, in verbal, maybe my target was 42. That was what I was preparing for. That was what I hit during my last mock 2 days before, I think 1 point extra, 43. But this was my target to get into a 42, 44. And I wanted to get it comfortably. So I was fairly comfortable in the 42 range. I was 100% sure of the answers that I was marking. On the test day, I wasn't. I was a little uncomfortable, maybe because the difficulty level was up. Right, to a 46 level. So maybe a little luck factor, but I think even luck requires your mind to be conditioned that way so that you can think that way, that this option A, which might look absolutely just eliminated right off the bat, kind of an answer to an untrained mind. One who has trained feels that this is the answer which I feel, the logic that I'm drawing in my mind. This can work. Option C might also work, but I feel more comfortable with A. On the test day, maybe those luck factor also kicked in and I got all those answers right. But then again, maybe 2 weeks earlier, I wouldn't even have thought of option A as a contender, right? So that's where your mind needs to be conditioned in the right direction. And if you want to get an extraordinary score, of course, there's a little luck. But yes, do train as much as possible, especially in verbal. It's very objective. It's not as subjective as people think it to be.
Yeah.
It's a very methodical approach to all the three of them. But especially SC, I was really surprised by how objective that section is after I got through e-GMAT. And I actually felt so good. I actually went back and told my friend, I'm actually feeling confident about this retest because now it's not, relying on my ear, but it's relying on rules and what to do in each sentence and how to look for the modification error, parallelism error.
So I think the typical condition for essentially doing well on SC is that when you can tell objectively, then hearing it, and you know that this is the answer without just hearing it and saying, okay, this sounds right, you can logically come to that conclusion. That's when you know your SC's gotten really good. So I think you definitely got to that point, and that's really cool. I think...
Is my internet connection?
I think it's a little up and down right now. Just give me a sec. Let me check mine as well. Yeah, should be okay now. Should be fine now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Now. Yeah. When in SE, you can come to a logical conclusion without really
thinking. Yes, and how it helps is, and see, if maybe by going by your ear, you might get it right, but you lose a little bit of your confidence because... But when you do it absolutely with bang on rules, you feel so confident on the next question as well, so on the next question. So it really helps to have an approach that is airtight. You feel more confident during the test.
Got it. So I think this has been very, very informative. And I think it's been a really nice interview. You've been very helpful. And I think there are a lot of good points here to take away for any student who wants to score really well on the test. Once again, congratulations on scoring the 760. We're supremely happy for you and all the best for your scholarships and B-School applications.